Well, you've noticed on stage, we've been joined by Dave MacLennan, who's the CEO of Cargill. I asked Dave what his walk-up music was, and then we realized neither of us could answer that, so we just brought him up on stage. But please welcome Dave. It's a wonderful thing for you to be here today. Thanks so much. Yeah. It's really special because he's obviously doing business around the globe, and it means a lot to have him here today. Dave, we've heard from a lot of people, these young students, Hamze, many others who have this background around the globe, a couple of white guys sitting around here talking. I didn't grow up around people speaking other languages. I didn't grow up around a lot of other cultures. You're now immersed in all of that. How did you grow up? What was your global experience growing up? Were you prepared for all of this when you began this whole adventure?
I'll start with your last question first. No, I wasn't prepared for all of this. And I, like you, RT, you hear people's stories, whether it's Omar or Hamze, it's very humbling. I was born into privilege. I was born into a middle-class family. I was born in Boston, Massachusetts, and lived in and around the Great Lakes cities of the United States. I didn't leave the country until I was 20 years old. But since then, I've been in 65 separate countries around the world, mostly because of my job at Cargill. So you come to appreciate the global community and how much this community, but also how much this country has become more and more diverse. For example, I went to a small liberal arts college in Western Massachusetts, which was about 15% diverse. Today, and I just joined the board of trustees of that school, it's over 50% wow. Non-white, non-American. So it better reflects the world. I heard Omar say it, we're better as people, we're better as a community, we're better as a country with more diversity.
Well, you know, it's a really interesting thing to think about that background and how you built those skills over time. The first time I was in, I think it was in Japan, doing business for the city of Minneapolis, I was there for a week, and I wrote a really bizarre email to my wife saying, I'm around people all the time, but I've never felt so lonely in my life, and I don't know what that was. I put my finger on it later that I'd traveled, but I'd never been trying to lead in a place where I was not part of the majority culture. Did you ever, like, what kind of experience did you have when you first started getting around the world and trying to navigate through that? What was the wall? What wasn't the wall?
And the experience you had, did you ever, there was a movie called Lost in Translation with Bill Murray.
It's a great movie.
And it spoke to me in that you feel very lonely and very separated from home. But it is a wonderful and frightening and empathetic moment when you first go to a culture that is not your own. And particularly Asian cultures. I mean, think about if you go to Western cultures, you look like everybody else. If you're people like you and me. You go to an Asian culture, you go to an African culture, you don't look at all like anybody else. And then you know, this is what many of my friends and colleagues and people of diverse communities feel like every single day.
Right.
And so you develop that sense of appreciation and respect and empathy when you get out of your comfort zone and you know what they feel like every single day, culturally and ethnically and socially. And I think that's what's so striking and so important about getting out of our own communities and traveling the world, if you have that privilege, to have that appreciation. And I'm coming back to the word empathy and understanding for what many people experience as part of their daily life.
Well, it's also interesting to draw a through line from that to the experience of a Native American and an African American boy walking around downtown Minneapolis. It is a similarity. When you have thought about, now you're running a big company, your job is to make money for Cargill. You also, obviously, there's a Cargill Foundation. How do you navigate between, first off, how much money you put into a foundation, how much effort into that, and how much to, you know, we know the CEO is in control of everything and not necessarily, you know.
and yet nothing.
Yeah. But how does that work within, like, does a board of directors say, hey, we're absolutely going to put this much in, or what sort of marching orders did you start with, and how have you influenced that?
So, and you pointed out when you introduced, I wasn't here, so I didn't see, were you from Margaret Cargill Foundation?
Who? Yeah, Terry.
So Terry, when I was listening to you speak, Terry, the Margaret Cargill Foundation, she was the largest, and they are very different. One is Margaret Cargill is maybe fifth, top 10 in the world. Cargill Foundation is puny by comparison, but The Margaret Cargill Foundation was formed about, I'm going to say, 6 or 7 years ago. Margaret had passed away. She, at the time, was the largest single shareholder of Cargill and left her money to a charitable foundation. The trustees wanted the stock, and so they sold their Cargill stock and formed the Margaret Cargill Foundation. So we take a lot of pride, and we appreciate the fact that they left the Cargill name on it, but they are different. But nonetheless, that is wealth, that, and the foundation was created from 153 years of Cargill and MacMillan family members and employees that created that wealth. So we feel a real kinship. We put 2% on a rolling basis of our before-tax profits into the foundation. So it is formulaic, but sometimes we, you know, it depends on the year, but in the last 2 years, I have, in consultation with our Cargill Foundation Board of Directors, made a recommendation to the Cargill Inc. Board of Directors and said, we would like to contribute an additional X million dollars to the foundation. So there is a process, but the thing that makes me the most proud of the company that I work for is the sense of philanthropy, whether it is being enacted through the Margaret Cargill Foundation or Cargill Foundation, and the sense of commitment to, yeah, we want to make money. We're a for-profit organization, but we take our commitment to the communities where we live and work, and our statement of purpose to be the leader in nourishing the world in a safe, responsible, and sustainable way. It is a very values-based company, and one of which I'm very proud.
You know, this is this interesting discussion that goes on in philanthropy, and it seems to be especially in corporate philanthropy, about the fact that no matter how much someone in your position puts into the foundation, it will always be minuscule compared to the marketing budget for the whole business. Yeah. And historically, there was this big wall between where the foundation was and where the marketing business was. So a lot of people on the outside over a number of years have said, boy, if we could somehow figure out a way to inspire that company to leverage their marketing budget. Began this whole discussion about, should the foundation have goals that are very separate or similar to, and then where is that line that goes there? I mean, because you could drag a whole lot of money into philanthropy if it's sort of the marketing purposes, and yet that's not as pure of a giving clause. It's an interesting tension.
It is an interesting tension, and the good news is, we, since we're a privately owned company, and since our products are primarily business to business, we don't have a big marketing budget. So there isn't a big tension there. We can, you know, we don't have to think, which, like a lot of branded companies where they have a massive marketing budget, we're just, again, for those two reasons, it's not as much of an issue. But I think our own marketing and brand building is done through our communities, through our charitable work, through our foundation giving, and through the time that our employees give in working in those communities. So to me, that's all the marketing budget we need.
Right. I was having a conversation with somebody who retired as the leading philanthropy for one of the big oil companies. When I heard about his job, he sounded very much like a Secretary of State going into different countries, negotiating with these business political leaders, not necessarily the most open governments, not necessarily governments you'd necessarily admire. You have to deal with the philanthropy side, the business side, and all of that. How does your work with these other governments vary across the world?
Yeah, I mean, we do business in 125 countries around the world. We have a physical presence in about 70. And I want us to be considered as a local company. We're not. I mean, they know we're an American owned and based company, but I think the ultimate compliment is if they see you just like a local. Yeah. And that takes a lot of time and a lot of work, but you build relationships with the federal government, the national government. So let's talk about China. You know, I spent a lot of time meeting with top government officials in Beijing. But you also develop very local relationships with the provincial leaders. So I also spend a fair amount of time meeting the governors of the provinces, particularly in the north of China, which is the agricultural belt, getting to know them, building a personal relationship with them, and letting them know we know that we are guests in your country. We will treat your people, your communities, your natural resources with dignity and respect. But we also recognize we're a foreign country of company as well, and then you've got to protect your people and recognize the difference. So it's threading that line or navigating that line, but respecting the fact that you're there because of their courtesy, but they like having food companies there. I mean, they want us to invest. It's not just about a food company. They want us to invest capital to provide jobs, but really to help bring nutritious food in, as I mentioned, a safe, responsible, and sustainable way to their population.
Right. Sarah, how are we doing on time? Good, because I want to open it up for some questions and comments from the audience. Do we have any questions or comments for Dave? Go ahead, and stand up and introduce yourself, too.
Hui Pham, Centers for Victims of Torture. Thank you for your comments. I just wanted to hear your perspectives in terms of your company relative to the sustainable development goals.
Well, first of all, that's a very good introduction because I have a sustainable development goal lapel pin for RT Rybak. courtesy of Mark Ritchie. Mark, wave your hand. Thank you, Mark. I left mine at home, so I was walking back to get a cup of coffee, and Mark had his on, and I said, that was brilliant of you to remember yours. Mine's on my dresser. He goes, here, I've got two. Give one to RT. Yeah, so now RT has one. We're very committed to the Sustainable Development Goals. We attend, I was just in New York last month during UN General Assembly. We always participate in panels talking about the Sustainable Development Goals and how it ties into our business purpose and to our business plan. We have several important partnerships around the world, the most prominent of which are the Nature Conservancy, the World Wildlife Fund. We just created a new partnership with an organization called One, which was founded in partnership by Bono of U2. And so we have created this partnership in which their mission is to end poverty, and particularly with a particular focus on women. So we have several partnerships. We try and focus on the ones where we can have the most impact. But as I mentioned, with our statement of purpose and our commitment to the environment, the SDGs are a very important part of our business.
Can I take another question? Stand up and introduce yourself.
Peggy Grieve, a donor at the foundation. Some of the other speakers talked about the input from their employees in trying to form the company's giving role. Could you talk a little bit about that at Cargill?
Yeah, so input from our employees. First of all, the board of our Cargill Foundation includes some non-Cargill employees, but the majority are current employees to have that input. The Cargill Foundation is focused on Minnesota and particularly the Twin Cities community. And so I think what I like about what we've done from a foundation and a giving strategy is, as I mentioned, we're a broad, big global company, but we also take our commitment to the community very seriously. And particularly in our headquarters community. I listened to the gentleman from 3M talking. We are like them. Half our employees are outside of the US, and half our sales are outside of the US. And so that, you know, the famous bank robber, Willie Sutton, why did you rob the bank? That's where the money is. Why do you move your business, or are you growing your business outside the US? That's where the mouths and the need is, the stomachs are. So our employees at the local level, they know which, whether it's through United Way or where the needs are. As I mentioned, the Cargill Foundation, we are very active in this community, and its mission, our mission through the foundation, is to close the opportunity gap in Minneapolis and St. Paul through education and through nutrition in particular. So for example, we are the largest funder of Achieve Minneapolis, which works in Minneapolis schools, and you know that, RT, when going back to your time as mayor. to close the opportunity gap and to support educational curriculum in the Minneapolis schools. We just started something called the Cargill Teaching Garden with a youth-only YMCA in North Minneapolis, which teaches kids how to grow their own food. It teaches them about nutrition, and it folds in concepts around STEM into the production, the home production of food. We've had a 9-year partnership with the Science Museum of Minnesota, which is teaching STEM and particular science curriculum in elementary schools in Minnesota. And we've just developed a new one, which is computational thinking in elementary schools. So that was direct influence from our employees and the board members of the Cargill Foundation. So I couldn't sit in my office and think, okay, what do we want to do in Bangkok or in Kuala Lumpur in terms of where's the need? It's all driven by our local leaders.
You're also just a new partner in something that we want to thank you for, is Connects MSP. Connects grew out of Itasca and Greater MSP. It was saying, we've got 27,000 step up graduates from all these other places with all these diverse cultures, but we don't know where they are. So we're creating this joint alumni association, and that's your work too. I want to ask you a final question. Let's just say I gave you $1 million. Don't fantasize too much, this is not going to happen, but let's just say I gave you $1 million and said, forget Cargill and everything else. Just Dave, with what you've seen around the world, and where would you put that $1 million in one place? What one thing?
The Minneapolis Foundation.
I should stop now, but yeah. Please.
And then through the Minneapolis Foundation.
There we go. There we
where
go.
Would we direct it? My wife Kathleen, who is here today and is in the back of the room. Hi. She won't stand up, but and serves on the board of the Minneapolis Foundation, had spent a considerable amount of time with Robin Schein in the last year to talk about where do we want our contributions to our fund to go. And we are focusing primarily, but not exclusively, on education and food nutrition. So Kathleen comes of a family who, her dad was a high school principal. 4 of her 8 siblings were in education. And so the importance of education to changing people's lives and to making a difference long term, we've been very involved. We've both been involved with College Possible over in St. Paul and on various board work, and then food. So just for a moment, Cargill also has been working in the North Market. So it's the Pillsbury United Communities North Market, where there's a significant food desert, but it's not just providing access to nutritional food, but also education around nutrition and health. But we are also, particularly in the north side of Minneapolis, looking at new opportunities for contributions relative to food and nutrition. So as I mentioned in the beginning, we recognize we were born into privilege and the vast majority of the world was not. And so we take our commitment to the local community, but also the global community. I think teaching people and then combining the two, sustainable farming and subsistence farming, particularly in Africa, is an area that we have a passion about as well.
Great. That shout out to North Market will be really appreciated by Shonda Smith-Baker, who leads all of our community impact. She was the brainchild of that, so she'll be very happy.
She was. I know. I know her.
Yeah. Could we all thank Dave so much? It means a tremendous amount for somebody leading a company to come here. Thank you so much.
Thanks for having me.